Welcome to another episode of Ask the Experts on Fox 4. I'm your host, Hannah Guthrie. Today, my expert is Craig Gordonier with Jones Advisory Group, JAG for short. Very cool nickname. I like that, JAG. It just sounds like a
Well, thank you very much. I wish I could take credit and say that I was the one that came up with it, but unfortunately, I was not. But, you know, if you want to give me, feel free.
The Jones Advisory Group. And today we're going to talk about your money in the time of COVID. And Craig, so many people are stressed out over this. I have a friend who, when COVID first hit, maybe like in March when we were really hearing about it, immediately got out of the market, panicked, and then immediately got upset because the market kept going up. So how do we handle our money in the time of COVID?
Well, that's a very good question. And truly, before I dive into that, Tana, one of the things I want to talk about is just, you know, how historic this drop was that we witnessed and how quickly it happened. So from a historical standpoint, our markets in at the end of February, beginning of March, they had never dropped this quickly and within such a short time frame. So to put that in context, on Monday, March 16th, the Dow, which is a well-known index that a lot of people know what that is, it dropped in one trading day, 2,997 points.
That's enough to scare anybody.
Yes. Yes, it frightened me and everyone else. It scared my dog. you know, that was a 13% drop in one day. That was the fastest drop in the Dow ever in the history of our markets. And during that same time frame, the S&P 500, it dropped 30% in 22 trading days. Now, to put that into perspective, a 30% drop in our markets on the S&P is extremely rare. It's happened in the past, but it's extremely rare. 10% drops or pullbacks, no one likes them, but they do happen from time to time. But 30% is historic. And the second, third, and fourth fastest 30-point drops in I don't want this to shock you, but they all happened during the Great Depression, 1934, 1931, and 1929. So the point I'm trying to get across here is that what we just experienced was extreme volatility in a very short time frame. And what concerns me, especially when I look at people's risk and what's going on in our markets, is I don't necessarily think we're out of the woods. Do you think we're out of the woods yet?
No, because we don't know what's going to happen. I mean, there's still the unknown. And then, you know, people being laid off, you know, housing is still going well. There are certain segments of the economy that I think are actually booming. But I just think it's the uncertainty. We don't know.
Exactly. And here's how I look at it. COVID, it's still an issue. It started all of this and it just hasn't gone away yet. There's promising news on the vaccine front, but, you know, cases are stabilizing a little bit, but they're still on the rise depending upon where you look throughout our country. We're in the midst of social unrest and protesting and riots throughout our country as well. Unemployment is at an all-time high, even though the last few job reports have come back positive. We're still at an all-time high as far as unemployment goes. And who knows what's going to happen here in the fall. It's about time for schools to start opening back up. I'm one of the lucky few that the school district where I live is giving us an option, but that's not the case for everyone. And so if parents are having to deal with trying to homeschool and virtual learning, that makes working their jobs even harder. And if we can't get back to work, that makes it harder for the economy to start going again. And those items alone are enough to cause a big, drastic amount of volatility in our markets. But what makes this even more of a perfect storm is that we have the elections coming in the fall as well. And so you wrap that all together and gosh, even though the markets have come back, I think that we're in for still a bumpy ride. So what I would have your friend do is what he really should have done, and I wish and everyone can have this, is to know how much risk is in your portfolio. So that way you understand what the potential downfall could be if things go really haywire. So that's one of the things that we look at with every single person that comes in and sits down with us for a visit. So what I want to do is actually take a look at your portfolio, and I have the ability to go in there and analyze everything it is that you own and come back with what is the doomsday scenario? What is our catastrophic downside risk? And I actually, this one shocked me, Tana. Yesterday, I met with a gentleman It was the second time he and I had sat down, and normally during our second meeting is when I start to get more into the nuts and bolts of, you know, where are you right now? Are you on the right track? That type of analysis. First meeting is really kind of get to know, trying to figure out what you're trying to accomplish, things of that nature. Well, I got to that point in time where I wanted to show him how much risk he really truly had in his portfolio. And this is what struck me, is that during our first meeting, one of the things I'm going to talk about is, what are you comfortable with and where do you think you are? What do you think this gentleman told me?
I don't know. How old was he? Let me guess. How old was he?
He was in his late 50s.
Okay, so late 50s. So I'm saying he's probably thinking maybe 60-40, stock 60, bonds 40. I don't know. I'm just guessing.
Well, that would be a typical, what I would refer to as a balanced portfolio.
Okay.
And folks that are nearing or in retirement, they like to use that type of blend because it still gives some growth opportunity. But also you're not truly risking everything because the bonds can act as a less volatile type of investment in your overall portfolio. And when I dug down deep and really started taking a look at how much risk he had in his portfolio, he had told me all along that he thought he was moderate and that he was comfortable being moderately allocated. But what I found is that he was at the upper end of being moderately aggressive, almost going into the aggressive range. So when I uncovered that for him and showed that to him, you should have seen the look on his face.
Did he kind of panic at that point?
Yes. Just like how my dog panicked when the Dow dropped 2,000 points in one day. So those are the type of things that before these catastrophic downturns in the market happen, you really need to know and understand how much risk you have in your portfolio. So when I'm meeting with folks today and trying to help them with my three ways to put yourself into a better financial future with everything that's going on with the coronavirus and everything else that's in our world right now, knowing how much risk you have in your portfolio, in your portfolio is crucial, especially if you're already retired and you take a, for him, the amount of risk he had, if things were to go really haywire again, he ran the risk of losing 47% of his overall retirement assets.
Well, I think that's a really good example of why you need a financial advisor, somebody to also hold your hand. Because when you do think about the fear factor, you know, if you're jumping in and out of the market, and at some point you have to stop and say, okay, that's just on paper. If you're not taking your money out right now, that's just a paper loss. So how do you counsel your clients through the fear?
One of the very first things that I do to help counsel folks through the fear is before you even can go down that path, first off, you need to know how much you have at risk and what is your catastrophic downside risk. And then if that is uncomfortable for you, then what my job is to help you. And I do this just by reshuffling your deck, which means just taking some of your assets and repositioning them to then bring down that catastrophic downside risk. So an example for this particular gentleman, what the game plan is, again, just to reshuffle his deck, I'm going to take his 47% catastrophic downside risk, and I'm going to cut that by four times. So that's the first place to start. And then once we get you into that position where what you have at risk is comfortable for you, then it's our philosophy that time in the markets is what really produces those long-term gains for you. So all the studies have shown those folks that try to get in there and time the markets, well, they usually don't do all too well. And here's why. Because to be able to time the market, you have to be right twice. It's true. It's true. History has shown.
It ain't gone out.
Exactly. It's hard enough with all the volatility in the market just to get right once, let alone twice, to be effective at timing the market. So all the studies have shown that if you get that wrong just half of the time, your growth would be cut in half compared to of just riding it out. So the first step is to know how much risk, get your portfolio aligned with that much risk so that way you can stomach and handle the ebbs and flows in the market, because there will be ebbs and flows in the market, and then ride it out accordingly.
And you've got to be able to sleep at night. Don't you counsel your clients on that? If you can't sleep being in the market, then you maybe don't need to be in it.
Absolutely. We actually refer to that as behavioral finance. So what behavioral finance dictates is that as humans, we are emotional creatures. It's just inherent in our nature. And if we are invested outside of our comfort level, then what happens is, as we see our investments go up and down and up and down and up and down, well, if that roller coaster ride is too much for us, then that's exactly what happens. It induces anxiety, it induces fear, and then we start losing sleep and things of the like, and then it's just human nature. When the coronavirus, things of that, pandemics and things that we don't know what's going to happen in the future happen in the markets, and it loses more than what you're comfortable with, then it's human nature to get out, move out of the market, and that's actually the last thing you're supposed to do. Because I refer to that as investing dyslexia. We all know we're supposed to buy low and sell high, but what did you do? You did the exact opposite. So that's what we want to help get you into a position where you're comfortable with the volatility, and then let the time in the market do its job.
Now, I've heard that there's actually more pain from losing money than pleasure from making money. It hurts more to lose it than to make it.
Mm-hmm. It's funny you bring that up, because you can also look at the markets as, and you can correlate it to a game. So I've heard many famous coaches, college football coaches and the like, state that exact same thing. Bill Self, I believe, was one of them I heard comment on that same aspect, that it hurts him more to lose a game than the joy he feels in winning a basketball game.
Let's talk about the game of taxes, because it is so confusing. I mean, you know, do you get in tax deferred funds, or can you tell us about that?
Yes.
Simply, so we understand it.
Yes. So when we're looking at what is going on in the markets and everything right now in our world, you know, the very first thing of my action points to do is to first know how much risk you have in your overall portfolio. Secondly, is to reduce future taxes where possible. So you hit on the subject that is always at the tip of everyone's brain when it comes to their investments. It's who wants to pay more tax than we have to? And so when I look at what's going on in the markets and I look at what's going on in our country, one of the very first questions that I ask folks is, do you think taxes will increase in the future? What do you think, Tana?
I'm thinking, yeah. Don't like it, but I think it will, obviously.
And I absolutely agree with you. And here is why. So there is this website. It's called usdebtclock.org. And I wanted to make sure I had accurate information. So 5 minutes before we started this conversation, I went and checked it out. And would you like to take a guess at what our federal deficit is right now?
I don't even know what the number, what's above trillion? Are we in the zillion? What is, I don't even know what the highest number is. I think we're there.
We're not quite that high yet, but as of a few minutes ago, it was $26.7 trillion on our federal deficit. Now, that is a mind-blowing number. I don't even know how many zeros that would be, but it's a bunch. And here's what's concerning, is that our government right now has already levied out $2 trillion in stimulus packages as of right now, that added to that $26.7 trillion. And they're in talks right now of doing a third round of stimulus packages, which I've seen estimates that could add as much as 1.3 up to maybe even close to an additional $2 trillion on top of that deficit. So my question then becomes, well, how are we going to get that under control?
Well, and if they keep printing money, aren't we going to have rampant inflation?
Absolutely. Absolutely. So something's got to give. And what I think makes the most sense for something that would have to give would be taxes would have to increase for us in the future. And so with that concept, you know, I wanted to, who knows what they're going to do from a taxing standpoint. Actually, the tax environment that we're in right now, taxes kind of, and I refer to them as being taxes on sale, because our current administration reduced taxes. And so those tax cuts that we're under right now are actually set to expire. And I also believe that if there is a party change, that they'll probably do something about our tax situation and increase our taxes on us as well. But I also wanted to have some context as to what has happened to us in the past. So I did a little bit of research, and I wanted to look throughout our history to find what was the highest marginal tax bracket that our federal government has ever levied upon us taxpayers. You want to take a guess of what that was?
I think it was pretty high. Would it be 60%? Was it ever that high?
It was higher.
Ugh. 70?
Yeah. So the highest marginal tax bracket occurred in 1944 and 1945, and it was 94%.
Why would you even work if you have to give away 94%?
Exactly. Could you imagine giving back 94% of your hard-earned money to the federal government? Now, do I ever think they will return to those historical highs? No. However, it is very feasible to believe, especially to get our deficit under control, that taxes will be increased in the future. So when I say what bullet point that people should be doing right now is reducing future taxes wherever possible, because right now we are in a low tax rate environment, and I think it's safe to expect taxes to increase in the future. So anytime you can get a chance to pay taxes today, I definitely suggest people to do that. And here's another way of looking at it. So when I sit down and I'm meeting with an individual in a family, and I see a tax-deferred IRA account and I see $100,000 in it, today, normally when I see that account, in my mind, I actually see $75,000 that they can use, because I know a quarter of that is going to, for most families, is going to go back to the government in taxes. What scares me is that without any of our control, it's very easy for that exact same $100,000 five, six, 7 years down the road, instead of me seeing $75,000, I could see $65,000 or maybe $60,000. And we didn't do anything except for our government decided to change our taxes. And so if you can pay taxes today, I highly suggest you do that.
Okay. No, that's very good advice. And I like the Roth because we've already paid taxes, right, on the Roth.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And so that actually reminds me of the lady that I met with just earlier on today. So when I was taking her through this analysis and showing her what type of tax savings that she could get in the long run by doing a Roth conversion, I was astounded, and so was she. So for those of you out there that aren't watching this video, or I'm sorry, who may not know what a Roth conversion is, I'm just going to explain what that is a little bit. So when we have these typical retirement accounts at work, or these IRAs that we started on our own, most folks have started those in what we refer to as a tax-deferred environment, meaning that the dollars I contribute, I get to write it off my income that given year. Since I've never paid taxes on those dollars, they go in and they grow tax-deferred. However, the IRS says, you know what? You never paid taxes on this. Down the road, when you withdraw them, they are 100% taxable to you, every single penny. Now, what a Roth does is it is the exact opposite. You fund it with dollars where you've paid the tax today. You get it into this tax sheltered environment of the free tax according to the Roth rules. And then as it grows down the road, you can take all your contributions, all your growth back, and you don't have to pay a single penny in taxes. It's all free to you.
So you might be better off than today transferring your traditional IRA into a Roth account because the tax rate is lower than what you foresee it to be in the future.
Bingo, you nailed it on the head. That's exactly 100% right. And so I have the ability in my models to show what kind of tax savings that could create in the long run. So if we all believe taxes are going to go up in the future, well, then that spread would be even larger.
And you can do the calculation, say if you're a high income earner right now, and in the future when you take it out, you're not going to be, but you can calculate what the difference would be roughly. Okay. Mm-hmm. Now, that hurts my head.
Well, you know, and you brought up something that I want to touch on for a quick second, and that is that whole idea of being a high income earner now and holding on to my tax deferred accounts for the anticipation of being in a lower tax bracket in retirement. And I think that is a little bit of a catch 22. And why I say that is because if you're retired, do you want to change your lifestyle? Do you want to all of a sudden turn around where you're in the situation where you pinch pennies and you don't use your retirement accounts?
We still want our cappuccinos and our nails done.
Absolutely. So why retire if you have to take a step back in your lifestyle?
Right.
So in retirement, it's normal for me to find folks that are in that exact same tax bracket that they were throughout their working years because it takes the income to maintain that lifestyle. Idea of, gosh, I'm going to be in a lower tax bracket in retirement, so it's not going to matter. Normally, that's not the case. You're usually pretty close to where you were throughout your working years.
Now, speaking of retirement, before you go, I want to know about that. So how do you guide people through the whole concept, I'm going to retire and I'm not going to get a paycheck, but I need money to live on. So how do you help them through that?
Very good question. And that actually brings me to my third action item on what folks should be doing right now. And that means that you should have a written plan for income in retirement. And here's what that means. So you nailed it on the head. And these are questions I get asked all the time when I'm sitting down and consulting with people for the very first time. They could be anywhere from 3 to 4 months out from retirement, or maybe 5 to 10 years out from retirement, but they can see that finish line and they want to put together a plan to handle it once they get there. And so they ask me questions like, well, Craig, do I have enough money to retire? Is my money going to last as long as I project to live? How's that money going to come back to me in retirement? Because once the paycheck stops, you know, most folks, Social Security is there, but, you know, pensions, they've gone by the wayside. So you need to have these retirement accounts to help fill the gaps. Social Security was never designed to cover everything. And for most folks, it only covers anywhere from 30 to 40% of their expenses. So they ask me questions like, well, what if there's a healthcare crisis? How risky should I be in these accounts? How often is the money going to come to me so I can pay my bills? What investments should I be using? And they ask questions like, well, you know what, Craig, I have this Roth account. I have an IRA account. I still have my account over in my 401k at work. I have a money market over at the bank. What account should I use and when? And so those are the questions that I help folks answer. And I help them devise what we refer to as our written plan for income in retirement. So that way, you know what account to use and when, we know what account to use and when, and we have it detailed out to show you a path on how you're going to use these accounts over time to generate the income to supplement Social Security. And if you're lucky enough to have a pension, to then give you enough income to go do all the fun things you want to do in retirement and pay your normal bills. Because the way I look at it is that if you're a family that works with us and works with Jones Advisory Group, when your head hits the pillow at night, I don't want you worrying about whether or not you're going to have enough income to sustain yourself in retirement. And by having this plan and having it in writing that we all know the path, it helps alleviate and answer all those questions for you.
Well, so how do people get in touch with you? Is email, phone, or what's the best way?
Well, all these different items that I just shared with you, it's all free analysis. We don't charge for any of it. It is crucial for folks out there to know where they sit in all those areas. So for anyone out there viewing this, if you'd like to come in and sit down with me, please, what I suggest is give us a call. Phone number is 877-374-4524. We would love to sit down with you, get to know you, see what you're trying to accomplish, and help you get there.
And you hold our hands through COVID-19, allay the fear.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And you know, you brought up something that I found that I still find interesting. So I can count, and we work with hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of clients. I can count on one hand the amount of panic phone calls I received during the market downturn in late February.
That's really good. Then you're doing a good job if you didn't have that many people call you.
And that's due to, first of all, understanding how much risk we have in our portfolio. If it's not comfortable for you, making adjustments to get that in line with the volatility that you can withstand, having a written plan for retirement income. So that way you understand, even when the ebbs and flows in the markets happen, we need the income. And if our income is taken care of, well, then all of a sudden you have that comfort level where you understand, even if the market does take a dip, it's not wrecking my retirement dreams. And that's where we help people get to.
Craig, thanks so much for talking with us. We really appreciate the advice you gave to us today. It's Craig Gordon here with the Jones Advisory Group. You can call them. And join us next time for another episode of Ask the Experts on Fox 4.